praise the Lord. Good morning, Life Point Church family. How are you this morning? All those that are here and all those that will be watching online, we are so glad that you chose to be a part of the service this morning. If you're you can hear my voice, come on into the sanctuary. Stand on your feet this morning. Let's lift our hands toward heaven. Father, we praise you. We thank you, God, for you being in our midst, because we lift a praise to you, God. You said when we lift a praise to you that you make a dwelling place, a habitation into our praise. So, Father, we praise you this morning. We enter into your courts with thanksgiving. We enter into your gates with praise and thanksgiving. And we glorify you in this place this morning. You are good. Somebody shout, Jesus is good. Amen, amen. Greet someone standing next to you. Tell them, give them a high five, a shoulder bump, a fist bump, whatever. Amen. Let's praise him this morning. Come on. Thank you.
Conquer. Strongholds are coming down, 'cause Jesus is lifted high. Strongholds are coming down, and Jesus.
Are coming down. Jesus is lifted high. Strongholds are coming down. Jesus is lifted high. Say that.
Strongholds are coming down.
How?
Jesus is lifted high.
Strongholds are coming down.
Jesus is lifted high.
I want you to think about this. That can anybody testify to your seeing strongholds or have witnessed strongholds over our nation? Right? And the only way those are going to come down is if we, if you, if I lift up the name that is above every name. Now, I don't want to be mean, but I want you to understand you don't need to get comfortable if there's a stronghold in your life. So what are you talking about? Fear is a stronghold. Doubt is a stronghold. Shame can become a stronghold. Because what shame will tell you is you ain't worthy. And all you got to do is say, I know I ain't worthy because he did it all. I give him the praise for what he did for me. Because we all have a past, amen? But those strongholds are coming down. How? Jesus is lifted high. Come on, say his name.
Strongholds are coming down.
Jesus.
Jesus is lifted high.
Strongholds,
strongholds, you're coming down.
Jesus is lifted high. One more time.
Strongholds, you're coming down. Jesus is lifted high.
So why don't you just lift your hands and begin to say his name this morning. Just say Jesus. Jesus, come on, say it all out of your mouth. Jesus, we lift you high. Strongholds are being broken in Eva, Alabama. Strongholds are being broken in Hartsville, Alabama. Strongholds are being broken in Fayetteville, Alabama. Strongholds are being broken in Coleman, Alabama. Strongholds are being broken in Fairview, Alabama. Strongholds are being broken in Africa and China and Taiwan and all across this world because Jesus is being exalted in the name of Jesus. Strongholds are coming down.
Jesus is lifted high.
Strongholds,
strongholds, you're coming down.
Jesus is lifted high. We lift your name, God. We praise you, Jesus. You deserve all our glory.
I've got nothing new. How could I?
Saints, let's sing it. Hallelujah. From you to God. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I throw up my hands,
praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And
I know it's not much, I'm nothing else fit for except. Say you're holy. Holy.
God is worthy. Him. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. 24/7, day and night, night and day, let incense arise. We lift our praises, day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Come on, lift your praise. Atmosphere, say this, you're my healer, you're my healer, you're my healer, oh Lord. Come on, confess that with us. You're my healer. Yes, you are. You're my healer. Right now, you're my healer. Oh, Lord. We're going to sing that again. If you need a healing, I want you to take your own hand. I want you to lay it on that. That where you need healing at right now. As we sing this, you're my healer. If you out back, Tom, if you out have knee problems, if you have heart problems, if you have arthritis in your body, if you have high blood pressure, you take your hand and you lay it on that spot right now. If you have stomach problems, if you have migraine headaches, if you have blurred vision, if you have ringing in your ears, if you have whatever it is that's going on right now, you lay hands on yourself and you begin to proclaim, "You're my healer. You're my healer." Right now, bad knees is being healed. Shoulders is being healed. Ears are being healed. Headaches are being healed. Blood pressure is being healed. Yes, you are God. Bad backs are being healed. Muscles are being healed. Ligaments are being healed. We praise you, God. We praise you, God. Come on. You're my Him right now. What you couldn't do before you laid hands on yourself and begin to proclaim that he's your healer, you begin to do that right now. You begin to check yourself right now. You begin to do that you couldn't do before, and you begin to praise him. You begin to praise him, whatever that you for what he done just in those matter of moments, as you begin to lift a praise to him. We glorify you, God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are our healer. You are our deliverer. You are the one who paid the price that we could not pay. You paid the debt that we owed. You didn't owe a debt, we did. You paid that debt, we couldn't. We praise you for that today, Father. We glorify you, Jesus. Oh, Lord, yes. You're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. Yes, you are. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. One more time. You're worthy. Come on, sing. Worthy of it. You're worthy. Glory, for from you are all things, for from you are all things. Share. Make sure her mic's loud enough and share what God gave you to speak.
I kept seeing people hold their hands over your eyes, and then I heard God say, "You've been looking at the wrong thing." I don't know if those wrong things are the circumstances.
Okay.
He didn't tell me that, but he said that he wants to clarify your vision today. Yeah. To look where you're supposed to look.
Amen.
Which is through the Word.
Amen.
Just that was an encouragement.
That's right.
Yes.
And I'm going to add on that. And you've been seeing dreams. What I'm hearing is you've been having dreams and visions that are God-given. And you keep saying, when is this going to happen? I can see myself doing this. I can see what you're wanting me to do. But God, when is this going to happen? And instead of asking the when, you begin to see. And this is what the enemy will try to do, distract you so you can't see. And what I'm hearing is opportunities for it to be manifested. Let me say that again. Instead of waiting on somebody to tell you to do it, God's already told you to do it. You begin to see opportunities to move in that for it to be manifested in your life, because the calling's on you, the anointing's on you. So if that's more than one, that's fine. But if that's you and you're saying, God, I'm going to stop asking, when's it going to happen? I'm going to start looking and listening by the Spirit of God and seeing by the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost that lives on inside me. I'm going to begin to move in what you've called me to do. Is that you? Just raise your hand right now and leave them up. Leave them up. Leave them up. I know God's called me to do this. I can see myself do this. So, Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, you see the hands that are raised. And, Father, we don't look to the right or to the left. We are not distracted by the waves or the thunderings or the lightnings. You've given us a word, as you did Peter when you went walking on the water. You told him to get out of the boat. And when he got out, he walked on the water to you. Father, we are walking by faith. Father, and we're in agreement with our brothers and sisters right now that they're walking into that plan, that purpose, that destiny. Father, they'll not stop asking the whens or the whys, and they'll be obedient and walking into it in Jesus' name. Now, you rejoice with them as they move in to their destiny and what God's called. Come on. If that was you, you'd be having a Holy Ghost fit right now. So why don't you have a Holy Ghost fit for them? Amen. Come on, one more time. Give him praise. Amen. What you don't understand is this is what God's called them to do. He's not asking you to walk into their vision. He's asking you to help them walk out their calling by praying for them and supporting them. Amen? Glory to God. Ain't it good to be in the presence of Almighty God this morning? Hallelujah. We're so glad you're here. And we want you right now, just for a few moments, we want you to, if there's somebody here you don't know or you haven't met, would you go and introduce yourself right now and tell them it's good to see them at Life Point Church? If you're watching online, we're so glad you're watching this week. So why don't you do that right now? Fellowship one with another and tell them how good they look this morning.
Awesome in this place. Jesus, you are awesome in this place. Worthy to be praised. Jesus, you are worthy to be praised.
Well, I'm glad that those of you that are watching online are tuned in today. Thank you all for being here. I'm going to say this. If you're a little bit warm, our air conditioners are struggling to keep up. You can pray for them. Amen. Those of you that think it feels good, you need help. Hallelujah. We'll pray for you too. Announcements. Next Saturday morning, guys, young men, we're going to be meeting at the Wagon Wheel Restaurant for breakfast, for men's breakfast at 7:30. We'd love to see all of you show up, and we'll overwhelm the place, and they'll get blessed because we'll tip well and pay for our food. Amen. But we'll get some good fellowship together, so come and be a part of that. Also, if you would like to be a part of our prayer team, we're revamping that, and let me just say this. While we're going through this leadership training, we're looking at every department, every ministry of our church, seeing what we can do better, how we can make it better. I'm just announcing that to all the leaders. I hadn't told you that yet, but you need to know that. And so if I come to you and say, we need to make some changes, you can just be ready, because I believe the Bible teaches that we examine ourselves. I believe churches need to look at themselves and what we're doing. And if we fell into a comfort zone called a rut, then we need to get out of it.
Amen.
And all of you can say amen or not,
amen.
But that's the truth.
That's the truth.
And so we still got our school drive going on. For disinfectant wipes, tissues, paper towels, that kind of stuff. If you want to give towards that and not go shopping, just put that on your envelope. If you're interested in joining our church, making this your church home, being a part of our church family, please see me or Pastor Rodney about that so we can have a membership Sunday. And then next Sunday morning, we're having water baptism service. I've got a couple of people that's already said that they want to follow the Lord in baptism. So if that's something you want to do, you don't have to call me. You just need to show up with some baptizing clothes and some towels.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. Or we'll have some towels and you can go home in wet clothes if you choose to do that. But we'd love to take part in that and to get you where you need to be spiritually. You know, I got baptized as a teenager. Years later, I got baptized again because I felt like it was a right thing to do. I felt like God was in it. And then a few years after that, in the midst of a church service that went on for like 2 or 3 hours of baptizing people, and they were falling out in the baptistry, and we were dragging them out, and people were going home and getting clothes and towels and coming back, I got baptized again. And you know, that was just a special day. So if you feel like you know you need to be baptized again, there's no shame in this. We don't actually have a biblical principle for more than one water baptism. Doesn't say you ought to, or doesn't say you can't. So I'm just saying, if you feel like, hey, I made a fresh commitment, I need to do something for me and for God, stating this, then we're all for that. So just let me know about that. Amen?
Amen.
Giving, Pastor Rodney's fixing to come and receive the offering. 84321 is you text to give. You can give on their website, discoverlifepoint.church, or you can write checks or give cash in the typical way. If you're here for the first time today, there's a Connect card that should be in a chair back in front of you. We ask that you fill that out and put it in an offering bucket or leave it in the chair or give it to one of our ushers to make sure we get it. If you've got a prayer request, This is how you do it. You can shoot us a message or whatever, but you can write your prayer request on there, and I promise you, we pray for you. We make a point of it. So just avail yourself to all those things. Pastor Rodney, would you come as our people get excited about giving?
Amen. Glory to God. Good morning again. Good to see you. I want to do something real quick, just a little bit different. If you are, somebody's going to have to help me out here in just a few minutes in case I forget any. If you are involved in helping in the nursery department, would you stand on your feet? Just stay standing, okay? Give these guys a hand. If you are involved, stay standing, stay if you can. If you're involved in children's ministry in any aspect, that's Sunday morning, Wednesday night, boys, girls, stand up. Give them a hand. If you are involved in media, camera, sound equipment, running sound, in any aspect, on Wednesday night, Sunday morning, stand up. Come on now. Give them a hand. If you're involved in praise and worship, whether you play an instrument or you sing behind a microphone, would you stand, please? Give them a hand. We are so proud. If you are involved in greeting and ushering, whether you're in the parking lot or you're at the doors or ever what, if you're doing sign-in with the kids back here, would you stand, please? Come on, give them a hand. Now, if I've left out any ministry and you're involved in another ministry, what? Youth, if you're involved, well, I told you, if you're involved in youth ministry on Wednesday night or any other night, if you are involved in helping in college and career, you stand to your feet this morning. Come on, stand up. Glory to God. As you can look around and see, there's a lot of people standing up. You can be seated. And this is for Sunday. Ladies ministry, stand up. Come on now. Well, you sat down awful fast. Amen. And again, we want to invite you next Saturday morning, be a part of the men's ministry meeting at the Wagon Wheel at Eva at 7:30. It's going to be awesome. Amen. And we got some other things that are going to be going on. But you say, well, that's a lot of people standing up. Looks like y'all got it covered. No. Am I right? No, we need you to be involved wherever you can plug in, whatever that calling is. And the reason I bring all that up and wanted to do that this morning is because Fourth Sunday is Ministry Sunday. And if you're involved in any of the ministries of the church or want to get involved, and right now, for whatever reason you can't, you can sow a seed of support into those ministries. Amen? Yes. And I forgot the Sunday school class on Sunday morning. See, I told you I was going to need help. But a part of that Sunday school class. And what we want you to understand is God needs all of us in the game. Wow. Well, I'm too young. No, you're not. I'm too old. No, you're not. Did you know I've read my Bible and there's no retirement system in the Bible until you get to heaven? You can retire when you get to heaven from the ministry. You love me? You say, well, I'm not strong enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm not this or I'm not that. Look, the enemy will try to keep us all sitting down. The enemy will try to, and I understand things, all right? We all have things. In fact, Jesus told a story in the New Testament about bidding them to come to a supper one night and all the excuses this man got. And you know what he did? He told them to go into the highways and hedges and bring those in and feed them from his table. So what I want you to understand is that every Sunday when we have opportunity to sow into a ministry, we have first Sunday is mission. Second Sunday is supernatural offering giving. Third Sunday is building fund. This Sunday is student, not just student, but ministries, LifePoint Ministries. Whatever you're involved in, sow a seed, a faith seed. Make a planting so that you can reap a harvest. Amen. And hey, next Sunday, we have a fifth Sunday in this month. Yes. Glory to God. Yes. Pastoral care. And it's all important because it's important to God. Amen. So if you have your tithes and offerings, you may give by electronic device. You may give on the website. You may text 84321. But if you have cash or check or your electronic device, let's hold it and let's confess this over our offering, and this is our declaration this morning. Father God, as we receive today's offering, we are believing you for heaven open, earth invaded, storehouses unlocked, and miracles created. Dreams and visions, angelic visitations, declaration, impartation, and divine manifestations. Anointings, giftings and callings, positions and promotions, provisions and resources to go to the nations, souls and more souls from every generation saved and set free, carrying kingdom revival. Thank you, Father, that as I join my value system to yours, you will shower favor, blessings, and increase upon me so I have more than enough to co-labor with heaven to see Jesus get his full reward. Hallelujah. Amen.
Look at your neighbor. Say, God's got something for you to hear today. It's going to change your life. The Word of God changes our lives. Amen.
Amen.
Today, we're starting a new series. The title of the series is Money Matters. Ooh, I heard somebody say that. Well, let me say this. If you decide after today you're going to send me a hate letter, just keep it. I've already had a bunch of them every time I teach about finances. So you're not going to change my mind. The Bible has more to say about money than it does heaven or hell. It's the real truth. And so I'm not here to force you to do anything. We've already received the offering. I know that a lot of our church family already are tithers and givers. And so you're already bought in on what the Word of God says about it. The Bible says in Ephesians 4 that my job is to equip you to do the work of the ministry. My real heart, my real goal when we talk about finances is to see every person in our church family financially prospered from one place to another, that year by year they've gone up levels financially.
Yes.
3 John 2 says, "Beloved, I wish above all things that you would prosper and be in good health even as your soul prospers."
Amen.
The Bible's teaching there that there's got to be, the soulish is your mind, will, and emotions, that there's got to be a soulish realm change that affects our health and affects our finances. Real prosperity. You can have all the money in the world and be miserable. Real prosperity is more than that. There's things that money cannot buy. If you've got a sickness that there is no cure for, your only hope is Jesus, not money. But money, Solomon wrote in Ecclesiastes that money is the answer to every worldly problem. And I wish I could think of the chapter and verse in the translation. I believe it's in the Message or Phillips or Passion. But anyway, what he's saying is money will solve most all of our problems, right? You ever been without enough money?
Yeah.
I mean, right now, I watched a thing last night on the news about people that were literally saying, "I'm having to choose between buying groceries and putting gas in my vehicle. I'm having to make some choices." And I'm going to tell you, if we will learn and be willing and obedient to operate in God's economic system, which is found in the Bible, then we will survive through whatever the economic systems of this world. During the Depression, I wasn't alive. My parents were. But I've read a lot about the Depression, about how it affected people. And pastors that wrote about it said that none of their church people who were tithers went without. I want you to listen to that. Times were bad, but nobody that was tithing and involved in God's economic system went without. They had food to eat. They had clothes to wear. They had the basic things they needed in life. Some people actually prospered during the Depression. Most people don't know that. Cosmetologists never went without work during the Depression because it said that ladies was going to get their hair done. Machinists were not with it. They had work during the Depression.
That's right.
Now, a lot of people had work, but there was no money. My father said they had money. They weren't rich or anything. He said, "We had money, but there was nothing to buy." They virtually raised everything that they had. He said there was no money to buy it. He said the stores didn't have it. And so, you know, I'm telling you all this because I want us to take the next few weeks, and I can go ahead and tell you next Sunday is going to be talking about seed faith living, about how to sow a seed and name it and all of this. And you can say, "I don't believe in all that." Please come. You know, there's going to be a couple of people share their testimony of sowing seed, believing God for a miracle. And so, just because you don't want to believe it or you don't want to be involved in it doesn't mean it's not real and it's not true. You know, I don't know anything about flying the space shuttle. We don't use them anymore, the rocket. I don't know anything about it. But I can promise you I would ride in one of them if they'd let me. I would go. I would fly in that thing if they'd let me. So I want to know, but I want to know all that God says about money. One of the weeks we're going to talk about godly promotion, about how God desires for you to be promoted in this life, in your finances, in your life, and some things about it. And most people say, I don't know if I believe that. What we've learned, what we've done is we've not researched the Bible to see what the Bible has said about that. The Bible says promotion cometh from the north, meaning promotion comes from God. The Bible says if God be for you, who can be against you? There's so many scriptures and principles about that. There's some things that we're going to talk about, because it's not going to all about be about giving, because money matters is we want more to come in. We want more to come in and we want less to go out. Amen?
Amen.
And so there's going to be some things about promotion and how to put yourself, according to the Word of God, in a place to be promoted. Pastor Rodney had no idea what I was going to talk about all this today. And he gets to talking about opportunities and seizing the opportunity and all that. God gives us opportunities. Most of the time, we're unwilling or afraid to step into the opportunity.
That's right.
Because we think we're inadequate or unable. You know, this is the reality of this is God wants you to prosper. God's church has struggled in the area of finances and healing as long as I can remember. One of the reasons I didn't want to go into ministry is because there was, and it's still said today, is God, if you'll keep them humble, the church will keep the pastor poor.
Go ahead. Come on. Go ahead.
That was a very real statement. How many of you that are working a good job, making a good living, want to give that up to go to be poor or to go without? Nobody. You'd be an idiot. And so God wants us to prosper. God wants you healed and whole. That's why we believe in healing. You know, and everybody that I know that in my life that has prospered, that's a believer, has been a tither. My dad, Alan's dad, our dad, growing up, daddy was burned in a fire when he was around 18 years old, third degree burns, and could not get a good job. He would apply for jobs. When the plants were coming in Decatur, Monsanto, 3M, all of them, he would go apply for jobs, go for interviews. And when he went for the physical and they looked at his legs where the third degree burns were, they would not hire him. So we lived in that. But my parents were believers. And my parents were tithers. And I can remember as a young boy with four children in the house and a mom that did not work, a stay-at-home mom, my dad made $130 a week. If you want to count that out in a four-week month, that's $520. My dad wrote a $13 tithe check every week, because I remember so many times going in their bedroom on Sunday morning and looking at the check laying on the dresser, already written and prepared to pay his tithes on $130. We never went without food. We never went without clothing. We never went without housing. We never had our electricity turned off. We never didn't have heat. We never went without, ever.
Amen.
We grew a garden. We had all this stuff. But I'm telling you, we never went without.
Amen.
God performed his word. And because of that, I'm sold on it. I've told you before that when Jackie and I started serving God, and we had good jobs, and I think she was in college at the time, but we were both working, and we were tipping God about $20 a week. And I'm in the shower one Sunday morning, and God says, "Today I want you to start writing $65 checks as a tithe check." And I like to fell out of the shower. Because I didn't see how we could write a $65 check. But we did, and God was faithful, and I began to put into practice being a tither. And I'm going to get to scripture, but I'm doing the preface of all of this. You cannot start today, tithe today, not do it next time you get paid or whatever. It's going to be in the consistency of it that is going to be the victory in it. Because if you tithe today and you get paid next Friday and you don't tithe next week, that's not tithing. The Bible says to bring a tenth in more than one place into the storehouse. Today's world, there's people, I got online this week and was just looking. I was amazed at Christian organizations that now say you don't have to tithe. And I'm going like, I'm not teaching that and I don't believe that. And so I want to give you some foundation so that you can stand firm, because I've got friends that don't believe in tithing. And I will also tell you this, that you can serve the devil and he will cause you to have earthly prosperity. He will cause you to have earthly prosperity. You can have money, you can have houses, you can have toys, cars, boats, airplanes, you can have all of that. But I'm going to tell you something. You better enjoy all that here, because without God, you're not going to enjoy life in the hereafter. And I want to lay up treasures in heaven that moth and rust and all does not eat up, so that my reward in heaven is great. Because I'm going to spend a long time there. And if I live to be 100 years old here, it's just a vapor according to the Word of God. So today's the series is Money Matters. Today is What About the Tithe? As I said, I know that most people here are tithers, or the majority. I don't know what you give and what you don't. I don't ask to look at that stuff. I have an annual report that's given to me, but I basically look at I don't go down through everybody's name and see what they give. I don't want to live that way. I don't want to do that. That way I can say whatever I want to about money, and I am not picking on anybody, because I don't know. Malachi chapter 3, verses 8 through 12 is where we're going to begin scripture-wise. It's a very common passage of scripture, very familiar. It says, "Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings." This is God speaking. "You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessings that there will not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, so that he would not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And all nations will call you blessed. For you will be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts." As I've already mentioned, tithing is a tenth. A tenth, people say, well, is that a tenth after taxes or before taxes? Do you want your after taxes blessed or before taxes blessed? It's the tenth. Proverbs says that you bring it all. So it's after taxes. It's the tithe is on every increase that you have. You sell a car sitting in your backyard that don't run, and you sell it for $500, you pay the tithe on the car. You pay the tithe on whatever. You can't pick and choose in this. Now, the question is, since tithing is in the Old Testament, am I still supposed to tithe? That's the big question that most believers struggle with. That's an Old Testament thing. Am I still supposed to tithe? Well, let me say this. Tithing began hundreds of years ago before God gave Moses the law. At least 430 years, but about 600 years is what I really believe from some research, that Abraham tithed before the law was given. Abraham was a wealthy man. Can we establish that? Do anybody in here know anything about Abraham? He owned his own enough goods that he had his own personal army. Yeah. Not a little one. They were all equipped with weapons. They weren't out there with rocks and sticks. They had swords and shields and knives and all the current weaponry of the day. They were all prepared and trained. My guess is these people didn't go out and herd the animals for Abraham. They trained on a regular basis to be protectors and army. Abraham had vast herds. Because your meat was not gotten out at the grocery store. It was on the hoof. And every day, somebody was dressing a goat, a sheep, a cow, something to eat if he was going to have meat. He had servants. Abraham was very wealthy. Abraham got in a battle. We're going to look at Genesis 14, 18 through 20. I don't want to go through all of it, the whole Genesis. But it says, then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine, and he was the priest of God Most High. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abram of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand. And he gave him a tithe of it all. Now Melchizedek is considered to be a type and shadow of Jesus, or Jesus. King of Salem implies deity. So here's Abraham. He's won a battle. He's defeated his foes. He got the spoils from the army and all this. And he returned it back to a king. He kept, the men could keep stuff. But Abram gave a tenth. It was the first, it was the first time there was tithing. But this is the challenge I'm going to issue to you. Look what the Bible says in the next chapter about Abram. If I remember correctly, that's when the angel shows up and you're going to have a son. You're going to be prospered. You're going to have, and they were childless. So Abram paid the tithe or gave the tithe way before the law. Now in Hebrews, and we're going to read 10 verses in Hebrews, and I know that you may say, well, that's a lot of scripture in a sermon. Well, we need the scripture, the word of God. Amen?
Amen.
And most people don't go out and read the Bible every day. I hope you do. I pray you do. But Paul is writing here. We say this is Paul. And he says, for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, Hebrews 7, 1 through 10, who met Abram returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being translated king of righteousness and then also king of Salem. This is Melchizedek. That's why we believe, the theologians believe it's Jesus. Meaning king of peace. Without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginnings of days nor end of life, but made like the Son of God, remains a priest continually. Sounds like Jesus to me. Now consider how great this man was, to whom even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth of the spoils. And indeed, those who are the sons of Levi, who received the priesthood, have a commandment to receive tithes from the people according to the law. That is from their brethren. Though they have come from the loins of Abraham, but he whose genealogy is not derived from them received tithes from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. Now beyond all the contradiction, the lesser is blessed by the better. Here mortal men receive tithes, but there he receives them of whom it is witness that he lives. Even Levi, who receives tithes, paid tithes through Abraham, so to speak, for he was still in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. This is just another story about, and a little more insight into Melchizedek and then Abraham paying the tithe. Abraham was a very wealthy man. When I hear people say that God does not want us wealthy, and I look through the Bible, I cannot find poverty as being a part of the covenant of God. I cannot find it. I've looked, because I hate being told I was wrong. And I'll admit it if I'm wrong, and I've been told I've been wrong about teaching on finances before. But I've looked at this, and I've looked at this. I've never done a series on money since I've been here. We're not, a church is not in a financial bind. But I'm going to tell you, in economic times like these, we need to decide where our heart is.
Amen.
The Bible says where your treasure, your heart is, there's your treasure.
That's right.
In other words, where's your money going? And if you don't believe me in this, I challenge you to research your checkbook. Your checkbook and where you spend, or your bank statement does not lie on where you spend your money. Ooh, at least Gary got me. Your checkbook, your bank account does not lie where you spend your money. And so you can look, and I understand, you know, I live just like you guys. Now, not only this, this is an evidence of tithing before the Old Testament, I mean before the law was given. But there were some other places that the tithe is talked about. Jacob tithed. I'm not going to go there for sake of time today. Jacob was a tither. But let me talk to you about this. I want you to consider this for a moment. Adam and Eve tended the Garden of Eden, yet they could not eat of the fruit of every tree. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they couldn't eat of. Because they worked the garden, yet there was a portion of the garden that they could not reap the fruit of. I believe, and I've thought so for many years, that this could very well be a type and shadow of the tithe. Amen. Adam and Eve, although they missed it by partaking of the fruit, they worked the garden. And here we are, none of us are big farmers. None of us are drawing all of our money from, or all of our income from farming. So we understand agriculture, but we're not farmers that do this. We're not raising all of our food. We're not doing all of this. So we work jobs and we get paid money, right? Money is a tool. Money within itself is not evil. It's the love of money that is the root of all evil. God doesn't care if you have money as long as the money doesn't have you. When the money has you, then there's a problem. And so what we're looking at today is we get paid and we worship God by giving back to Him, giving the tenth. Now, let's talk about the benefits of tithing. There's some benefits to being a tither. If you go back... Let's just go back and look at it. God says in Malachi chapter 3 that there may be food in God's house. That literally means that the bills get paid here, that there's money to do the work of the ministry, and there's money to pay those that are employed by the church. Money to pay for air conditioning and electricity and water and all of those things. That's the meat. In the old days, the Levites... The tithe really went for the support of the Levites, and the offering took care of the temple. We'll talk about that maybe one day. But God said that there'll be food in my house. And the first thing God says, test me or try me in this. In other words, try tithing and see if I won't do what I said I'll do. Try tithing. Try it. He says, see if I won't open the windows of heaven and pour out unto you a blessing. And the blessing is that there not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer. In other words, so God says, if you'll be a tither, I'm going to bless you. Your 90% will be blessed and go further than the 100% would go. Amen. I've been a tither a long time. I know I'm old. Some of you look at me and think, he's just an old fuddy-duddy. But let me tell you this. It works. My 90% will always go further. You say, you hold back the 10%, I'm going to tell you the seed eater will be there, the devourer. And in the translation of seed eater in this means the devil. One of the translations of Satan's names is destroyer. You ever had rats get into anything in your house? Satan's a rat, but worse. But he will bless us. He'll open the windows of heaven to pour out a blessing, that there'll be not enough room to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes. There is a hedge of protection around our lives and around our income because we're tithers. God protects us. You and I do not know. We're going to get to heaven one day. We're going to find out how many times God spared us from trouble. I'm telling you, we're going to be amazed. I literally believe that. I believe we're going to get there and God replays the video of our life or whatever it is that happens there. And we're going to see where God stepped in and saved us, saved our kids, stepped in, protected us. It says, so that he will not be able to destroy the fruit of your ground. That's a job, not destroy your job, not destroy the income from your job. Nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field. He's talking about like grapevines not having grapes for wine, or olive trees not producing olives, all of this. He's saying that's not going to happen because of you being a tither. And he goes on and says, all nations will call you blessed. Every third world country, every person in a third world or developing nation thinks that every one of us are rich. They call us, you rich Americans. You rich Americans. And when you go into one of their homes, you will understand why they call you a rich American. In Haiti, they slept on dirt floors, lived in huts made out of wood and stuff like that. They cooked on a little fire out there, whatever they had to eat. It might be a tortilla. It might be some kind of ground corn or grain that they made into basically look like grits or oatmeal. And they're eating that three meals. And I like grits and I like oatmeal. But I don't like it every day. I don't like it every meal. Right? And so we are prospered. And as you do this in life, as you walk through this and walk this out, you can see God's hand on your life. One of the things that I noticed in our church in 4 years since I've been here is every year we have less and less people need help financially with certain things like school products, things like that. Everybody has a time that it gets tight.
That's right.
But what I've seen happen is God has prospered our congregation. And one of the things that can document that and back that up is our annual income is increased as a church every year.
Yes.
That provides some insight into God has prospered us.
That's right.
We should be very thankful. So the tithe is vital to this. When we look at all of this, I believe if you're a tither, you're in a covenant relationship with God to protect you. You and your family.
Amen.
God's covenant with us, because we're obedient in that one area, is strong. I believe that when I tithe and when I give, one of the things it does is it opens the door for God to get involved in my finances.
Amen.
I was praying about this one day. I don't have anything to base a request from God on when I'm not being a giver.
Amen.
He said in one place in the Gospels, it said some 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. Right?
Yeah.
But if I'm giving zero, and I was decent in math, and zero times zero equals
zero.
Or 100 times zero is still
zero.
I've not given God anything to work with. Let me ask you this. The little boy with the fishes and loaves. This is a children's church offering teaching. The little boy had five loaves and two fishes. Or two loaves and five fishes. I think it's five loaves and two fishes, but anyway. Anyway, he had some loaves and fishes. What did Jesus ask the disciples? Here is the Son of God, the creator of the universe. What did Jesus say to the disciples? What did he ask? First thing he said was, what have you got? What do you have for me to work with? And the little boy gave them the loaves and fishes. And that provided Jesus something to work with. If the Son of God needed something to work with to feed 5,000 people or more, is the principle not the same in our lives when we need God to operate in the realm of finances for us? I mean, I look at the principles. I don't just read the word. I look at the biblical principles I'm seeing established. I'm not saying God won't minister to your need out of grace and mercy. But I'm saying to you, if you're a believer and a mature believer and you've heard the word, there's time that we start operating in faith and doing what the word says. And so I see tithing in all of this as the foundation and the beginning of God financially getting involved in our lives. You know, a church that hoards up all of his money and doesn't minister to the poor, doesn't give to missions, doesn't give in areas where there's needs and things like that. Why would God want to send more money to that church? Two times in my life as a minister, I've talked with churches about going there to be their pastor. Two times, they both had $50,000 in the bank. And the question that they wanted to know before I went there was, would I leave their money alone? And I promised them that I didn't want to touch their money. And I said, I can believe God that if I were to come to here, and I didn't go to either place, if I were to come to here to be pastor, you can lock your money away, and God will meet every need, and we won't have to touch your money that they were so worried about holding on to that $50,000. And here's a spiritual principle that's not in my notes, but it's something we need to know. If we are so busy holding on to what we've got hoarded up that we're unwilling to minister that out and trust God, and I'm talking about a church. Now I'm talking about individuals and churches. If we're unwilling to minister that out to meet needs, then how can we expect God to be willing to bless us? There's scriptures about the generous person. I'm not saying don't have a savings account. I'm not saying don't have money put back for rainy days. I don't believe in rainy days. I believe in savings accounts. I believe that you put money back for plans for that kind of stuff. But these churches, both times, were so concerned about their money they had in savings that they couldn't see that they might. And I asked one of them, when they told me that, I said, what do you plan to do with that money? We don't know. We just don't want to spend it. And so I read scriptures like, if your brother has a need, he needs a shirt, you give him your shirt and your coat too if he asks for it. I read scriptures like, if he asks you to walk with him a mile, that you go 2 miles with him. Right?
Yes, sir.
And so we all get to make the decisions about what we're going to do with our finances. But I want to challenge you to look at yourself, look at your mindset on it. Because I'm not, you know what? I know this, that if I didn't get paid from this church tomorrow, I'm not paying, it's not tomorrow. If starting today I no longer drew a check from this church, God is not going to let me go without. I've done lived this too long. I've been unemployed before and I didn't go without. I know this, that every time I made a decision that I was going to be bivocational and I needed something to do, I picked up my carpentry's tools a couple of times and I can say this right now, I can't even get people to leave me alone so I can lay them down. God will prosper you. God will see you through. I just want to challenge you. Start reading what the Bible says about finances. I've got some books. I'm trying to find one of them so I can order a few. But in churches I pastored before, I gave out a book about tithing. And some of you that were in Abundant Grace and would know about that book, maybe Transformation, you may have a copy of it. But it talks about the head, about J.C. Penney, getting to the point that he lived on 10% of his income and gave 90% away. Of J.T. Letourneau, who started Caterpillar Equipment Company, did the same thing, lived on 10%. Henry Ford took the tithing principle and started planting it in grains of wheat and the seed sowing principle and proved them. Every man, and one of this is testimonies about people who did not believe in tithing, did not believe in giving, who started believing, who tried it, who test God in it, and in every case, they prospered. Every case. And so my challenge to you is, let's get in the Word. Let's find out what the Bible says about finances. It could be that's the one thing holding you back from being where you need to be. I'm just being honest. I love all of you. I want to see you blessed. it breaks my heart when I see church members who are doing all they can do and they're struggling. You know, personally, Jackie and I would love to have the income that we could write checks to missionaries and finance things all over the world, that we'd have more than enough. The Bible says that we come to, that God's desire is that you come to a place that you have more than enough and are able to sow into every good work. That every time there's a missionary, every time there's an offering, every time that God puts something in front of you, that you would have something to give into that. The Bible says, and we're going to talk about some more of this, that the person who scatters, and this is in their sowing, their seed sowing, who scatters on many waters, so they're reaping. There's a principle that we're going to talk about. I'm just telling you because I finished this a minute or two early. There's a principle that I believe is a prosperity and an increase principle. Is the Bible says, 6 days shall you work, and on the seventh day you should rest. And I'm not advocating working 6 days a week. I'm advocating having a 6 day work principle. You say, what do you mean by that? That you have investments that pay. Only nation in the world that really operates on a 40-hour work week is guess who? I know a lot of you don't work 40 hours a week. You work lots more. You're like me. You work 50, 60 hours a week. But there is something about this 6 day work principle where you have a side gig or you have investments that pay, that produces. I'm not saying don't have, you know, work 3 days a week if you're prospering in that, if you got that worked out. It's the principle of it that God is talking about. And one of the things when we talk about godly promotion is having a work ethic. Yeah. And parents, if you've got children, work ethic normally starts being taught at home.
Amen.
It really does. Amen. Chores. Oh, all the teenagers and the kids in here are looking at me like, I wish you would shut up. Chores. And if they don't do their chores, they don't get the rewards. You know what? 12-year-olds can learn to wash clothes.
Amen.
And mop floors.
Amen.
There's a couple over here that are going like that. You know, I know that none of you grew up like this, but our daddy had milk cows and sold milk. And Alan and I would get up and go to the barn before school in the mornings, and we at times had 3 milk cows, and Daddy would milk 1 or 2, and I would catch the slack, and Alan would feed all the others, the hogs, the cows, and he probably milked some too. We hated that, but it taught a work ethic. It you know, growing up, and one of the things that I've told my father and mother before they passed was that I appreciate you instilling a work ethic in us. And so there's a level of prosperity that comes from that. And so we're going to talk about a bunch of it today. I want you to stand. There's not an altar call to give to this. I'm not going to take up an offering. I want to challenge you to find what the Word says about it. I want to challenge you to teach your children to be tithers and givers. Because I know some young adults that started tithing and giving in children's church that are prospered today because of what they did. Amen?
Amen.
Father, thank you for your Word. God, your Word is correction, direction, instruction for life. Father, I thank you that because of your Word, God, that we can prosper. For your Word says if we would be willing and obedient, we eat the fat of the land. God, that it's not your will that your children be in poverty and lack. God, that it's not your will that we go lacking in any good thing. But it's your will that we have more than enough, that we can give into every good work. God, I thank you today, Father, that the people of Life Point Church are eager to know, to obey, and to understand the Word concerning every area of our lives. Father, I pray that you would prosper us. I pray this week, God, divine protection on us as we go, as we go about our jobs, our lives. Father, we thank you for that. I thank you today, God, that if any need is in this house, God is met. We pray today, Father, for that to be, for any need, no matter how big or small, to be met. And God, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you.